Hello.
Don't you go, won't you stay with me one more night?
Hey friends. So how's the dance party intro? Is that all right? I'm just trying to see if I can get with videos blocked by YouTube for illegal copyright sharing. But they are non-monetized. And they are for educational purposes, although Oingo Boingo has nothing that I can tell to do with our topic of the day. So how's audio? Can you all hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Loud and clear.
Awesome, and I can hear you loud and clear. How's everybody been? How you doing? How's fall? It's freaking October. Holy crap. When did that happen? I mean, I know today, but what the crap? Are you hanging in there okay? I'm curious, and you can drop. Okay, actually, two things. Can somebody track? Once we get going, I'm trying to do one other audio visual test, which is I was reviewing some of the video stuff. I've tried to enable streamer mode, which should turn off all the notifications, because without streamer mode, every time somebody drops a comment, it goes, you get that bloop, bloop, bloop. And if you're watching it on YouTube, like I was the other day, then you're like, who's hit me up on Discord, right? Because the alerts are going off. So I just want to make sure that we're getting rid of those because it really was distracting. Anybody got any take on that? Or if you want to just, make sure that somebody's dropping stuff and then we just make sure someone's watching on YouTube, you know what I mean? So we can check to see if the sound's showing up there. I'm not hearing any. Can I just get a volunteer to like leave the chat and then come back to leave the voice channel and come back to it? Just see if we get that bloopy bloop sound.
Yeah, I can do that.
Awesome, thank you. I got nothing. Everybody else got nothing on that? On audio?
I heard that, but I don't know if it's going up on YouTube.
Yeah, because I did not hear that. So I don't know if the streamer mode, when I go to streamer mode, and then if we could get somebody just to listen.
If you can't hear it, then it's not being recorded in broadcast.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Maybe it's just whoever's hearing it, it's on their end, not your end. So we wouldn't be getting like
that would be my of it. Right, that would be my assumption, right? One of the things I've learned over the years is just don't
get that old saying about ASSU and me.
That's right. Yeah, no, get used to disappointment, right? Or never, don't have the audacity to be afraid or to be afraid, to be shocked when something that makes no sense whatsoever is actually the thing because there's some other thing going on. Anyway, all right. Hey, welcome. Welcome back. Should we talk about Oingo Boingo? Should we talk about them? Or should we dive
straight? Let's talk about transistors.
Or should we go straight into transistors? Boingo, transistors. Call is yours.
Transistors has my vote.
Boingo.
I'd rather talk about Boingo. Let's be really honest here. But alas, it is our duty. It is our quest to understand more about circuits. And I hope everybody had a chance to watch the presidential argument on Tuesday.
Presidential mudslinging.
No, you shut up.
No, you idiot. You shut
you
up.
Clown.
It was like watching an episode of Beavis and Butthead. I just expected Cornhulio to make an appearance, I don't know. It was, anyway, that's all I want to say about that. That's just the presidential crap show. The unpresidential crap show, anyway. I did see, by the way, an article somewhere that said on the next debate, they're actually going to cut the mics when it's not your turn to talk.
One can only hope.
One can only hope. Holy crap. Yeah, that's my hope. I did really, really well on my debate bingo. I'm pretty proud of that. Okay, let's do the thing. Let's do this. We were talking circuits, as I recall. Right? We did the NOT gate, right? The inverter, we call it. It's called an inverter because signal comes in high, it drops and goes low. Or signal comes in low and it goes out high. Boom, inverter. Zeros become ones, ones become zeros. OR gates. So, okay, let's do this thing. This is the symbol for the OR gate, okay? It kind of goes directionally like you'd expect, left to right. You know, the pointy arrow, I can't even make my hands go like that. The pointy arrow going the way you would expect. And it takes, basically the way we're doing this one is as a binary OR, where you've got two inputs coming in and one input going out, right? And after that, it's just the OR function, the one you already know, okay? Now, you're probably wondering, if you're looking at this, like, okay, I got that A and B are the inputs, and then there's D, right? Which is, they've got to all be zeros for that to be a zero, otherwise they're ones, right? But you're like, what is C? What is C doing there? I will explain. But this should be just pure review on ORs. Here it is. That's the thing right there. Now, what I want to point out to your attention, I can't talk. What I want to bring to your attention is there's C right there. So the truth table just kind of has that as like an intermediate result. Okay. And we'll kind of show you some things that make that a little more sense. Okay. Because it turns out we have a name for C. We already have a name for D, right? It's OR. Anybody just off the top of your head? Some of you know it. If you don't, maybe you can just guess it. What do you call this guy? Anybody? Any guesses? As a logical gate, what would you call it? Just look at the truth table. Ignore the transistors. Just look at the truth table.
False?
No.
Not the contrapositive, is it? Or the...
Okay, A, I don't know what that means. I mean, I know the word, I just off the top of my head.
Okay, then it probably isn't.
I mean, it still could be, okay? But it turns out, would you have a descriptor for C using the word OR? What would you call this guy? Just think about it for a sec.
Nor.
You would call it nor. You could also call it not or, right? You can call it not or, but we condense that and we call it nor. It turns out that to build an OR gate, it's easier to build a nor gate and then just flip it. The nor gate is simple. And the OR gate is complex. That's kind of counterintuitive. I don't know why that's counterintuitive other than, you know what I mean? You'd think that the OR feels simpler, the NOR feels more complex. Nope, you build a NOR gate and then you flip it. So everything over here on the right, from C to D, you recognize this guy? Bueller, do you recognize this?
It's a NOT.
That's just a NOT, that's just an inverter. We already did that guy, okay? It's right there, that one right there. Come on, I didn't want to animate this whole slide right there. Right? That's this guy here. We already went through it. That's it right there. So all we have to do is get C to follow this truth table. When they're both zeros, you give me a one. Otherwise, you give me a zero out into C. Then you NOT it, and that gives you the OR. Cool? Let's look at this thing. Let's scout it. I got no volts coming in right now, so I'm doing 0, 0. Okay, we're just going to animate this thing. We're going to go. Okay, ready? 0 volts coming in. When that 0 volts is here, well, let's just do it, first of all. Well, yeah, power goes there, and nothing goes out there, right? You always got to have zero going to ground. Why? Burning down the house. I don't know. That's all I got, right? Zach had a way better answer, but I didn't understand it. It was all about electrons and crap. So I'm just going to go, don't be drawing all that power and burn your house down. So that guy has to go to zero. And what you'll notice, this is the pattern. And by the way, you know, I've got a monitor over here with what you're seeing there, wherever that is. And that's why I sometimes am looking here on the big screen. Notice that I've got three of these gates over here on the top. And then I've got also three gates on the bottom, and that they're the opposite, right? So these three, what are those? They're all the same kind of transistor, right? What kind of transistor? Bueller? You got two choices.
P-type.
What's that?
P-type.
P-type. That's right. That's right. They're P-type. Paranormal, right? These guys are N-type. That's the other one. But notice that they're always, there's two P-types here and two N-types here. A P-type here and an N-type here. That's kind of the pattern. Because what that does, when those are different, right? One's a P, one's the N, then the other one's the N, the other one's P. What that does is it goes, if one of them is on, the other one's off. So if I've got power coming, I shut it off. If the other one is off, power can stay on. It doesn't matter, right? Because nothing's getting through. Does that make sense? So that's why you'll see that pair up between something on the bottom end going to ground that's going to be the opposite of what was on the high end. That's the pattern. These are just little tricks to try to demystify it. You know what I mean? Because you look at this thing and you're like, wah, you know, your head explodes a little bit. And my experience is it's like, look, just give yourself some room to relax, calm down, let it settle in, and it kind of starts to make a little sense. So I got power coming in the top, nothing at the bottom. Here comes the zero, right? That first A, it's really faint. I hope you can see that, right? On the stream, on the screencast. And then here's the other zero, okay? Now let's walk through it. When I got power coming into that gate, and I've got, you know, on the line that the gate controls, right? And then I have no power to a P-type transistor. What does it do? So the gate is, you know, are we closing so that the circuit goes, or are we going to be open on a P-type gate? No power. What say you, Bueller?
Closed.
Right? Because our intuition on the N, normal, it's not really what it stands for, right? But N for normal, it's like, I give you power, and you make sure that the power's flowing, right? I close the circuit. Boom, great. For the P-type gate, it's like the opposite. When I have no power, I'm closed. And that's kind of the way to just remember that. The P-type is just the opposite, the paranormal, the peculiar, I think somebody said, which I liked a lot. Yeah, so that's going to be going, right? That's going to close. Boom. And when that guy closes, this guy opens to be broken. He disconnects, right? And again, use whatever terms make sense to you. But on the top, we'll say that guy's closed or he's connected. Down at the bottom, we'll say he's opened or he's disconnected, okay? But you see what's happening? The A line with the no juice, follow it down, no juice, round the horn, boom. No juice comes into an N-type transistor and... right? Breaks the connection. So what that means is, in case the power continues on through, it won't go all the way to ground. And this circuit right there, the middle guy, is the one that's kind of making sure that A, that when A turns on up there, it's off down there. Okay? B, it's going to be remarkably similar, right? B closes that gate or connects it, and then turns that one off. They're exactly the same function. Now, what's going to happen with the power? Boom, power goes on through, right? It passes through that gate, passes through this gate. It heads on toward ground and gets stopped right there because we stopped it so we don't have to burn our house down. But C now lights up. put another way, look over here. When A is 0 and B is 0, C is on, 1. Right? Voltage. Now you've got power coming over to these two gates. That's just the inverter. That's just the inverter, right? Power to a P-type gate does what? Connected or disconnected?
Disconnected.
Disconnects it. Boom. And then the opposite down here because that's an N-type. So this guy gets connected, that guy gets disconnected, which means no juice out the other side. And that's what we want. That's it, right? A is 0, meaning no voltage. B, no voltage. C has voltage there. And D has no voltage. And the truth table works. And if we just stopped at C, we would have a NOR. And that would be the truth table for a NOR. Everybody cool with that? Do you see how it's like there's a handful of moving parts and the notation's a little funky, right? First time you've seen that notation, maybe not, you know, some of you have seen it, but most of you have not. There was certainly nothing like this in Python last semester.
I think I may have missed the first part of last class where we were discussing like P-type and N-type, but I will do my best to catch up.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Which we're kind of explaining it as we go, a little bit of review. I think it'll make a little sense, Chris. Yeah, let's keep going. So that's the first one. Let's go when you've got A has no voltage and B does have voltage. That's this line down here. Do I highlight that? I really ought to highlight this while I'm doing that. Why don't I do that? I'm not going to do it right now, but I need to do that. Okay, right. So that's our setup. Power always has to come. There always has to be power to the circuit. The question is, these data lines don't have to have power. Because the data lines control whether the power coming in gets through, and that's how we build the logic of the circuit. Okay, let's do it. You know what to do? The zero comes rolling here, right? You know what that's going to do? The zero into a P-type closes the gate, aka connects the circuit, lets the power through.
Yep.
We haven't even gotten to that yet. But then we got B with voltage coming. We got B with voltage, A without. Sorry, we just talked about that guy. We closed that circuit. Boom. Power's going to run. What happens over here on B? Power to a P-type.
Disconnects it.
Disconnects it. We go boom. Now, and then as always, I'll stop saying this after a while, but as always, the guys down at the bottom are turning into whatever the opposite was, because that was a P-type, this is an N-type. That's always the pattern. Okay? So what that's doing, if you think about it logically, is, you know, that now there's nothing gets through. C gets nothing, because it was blocked right here by B. So it turns out, if you think about it, you got A and B. If either one of them is on, right, or a 1 or voltage, it's going to turn off that gate, right? You see what I mean? If it's on, it turns off the gate. So if A is on, gate's off. If B is on, gate's off. If they're both on, both gates are off. Off, off. Still off. But the only time the gate is on is when they're both low power, zeros. When they're both off, then the power gets through. What does that look like? Looks like the truth table for C right here. If anything is on for A and B, the answer is no. If they're both off, the answer is yes. And then, of course, invert that bad boy, boom, which is going to be, it's off, so that makes it go on. Because that's the inverter. Boom. Are we boom happy?
Boom.
All right. Thank you. Now this guy here, you're going to do the exact same thing. No shockers here. Okay. Spoiler. I'm going to tell you what the ending is. Yeah, you're right. And the bottom line is if either of these guys is on, the gate's going to be off for that one. That's it. Doesn't matter that this one's on over here. The B, the fact that that is like, yeah, my bridge is connected. Yeah. Well, back there, all the traffic was stopped back there. Yes, I'm so proud of you. Your drawbridge is there and it could be driven over, but there's no cars. So it doesn't matter, right? And then that, of course, gives you this happy zero, no voltage coming for C, hits the inverter. Zero into a P-type means power yes. Boom, flows out, you got voltage. And then, of course, this one, which we already talked about, so it ought to be kind of intuitive already by now, right? They're both on. A and B are both on, which means power into a P-type goes twice. So you go, yeah, I got power there. I got power there. You know, double bridge out, right? And then, of course, this bridge, the second one, doesn't even matter because you're not getting past the first one. That gives you a zero on the C. Zero to a P-type gate means we close it so that the power can flow. Comes on through. Boom. One. Is that cool? Now, here's the deal. Some of you, however of you, many of you are here or watching on YouTube on the tape delay, if you're at this point going, wait, just back it up 15 minutes. Go to where after I talk about the debate, the presidential crap show. After that, when I start talking about this, just go through it again and stop and do it yourself. You know, be like when I get to like, when I'm like right here, do it yourself. Stop and just go, okay, so I got power coming here, and then I've got, that's going to be, you know, do it yourself. And that's how you get the fluency. And it's not, it's really, truly not rocket science. I don't even know what rocket science is, really, but I know this isn't it. Okay, let me get past this since I moved back. All right. And voila, we reveal to you now the NOR gate, which we already revealed to you, really, right? But this is how you represent a NOR gate, okay? You got the OR with the little circle, right? That circle always means not. It just always means not. That's why, like, on the P-type gate, it tells you it's not, you know what I mean? It's the opposite of the N-type. Here, it tells you it's the opposite of the OR gate, because that's an OR gate, right? That's just an OR gate with a little dot on the end of it, a little circle on the end of it. That's the not. And as we already talked about, the not symbol was just a triangle with a circle. And the triangle is just there to kind of say direction and do a not on your way through. Okay? Yeah, so we already did the NOR gate. There we go. But this is redundant. I don't even need to do this. We did this already. But if we just look at it this way again, this is kind of exercise, I guess, right? When they're both zero, these guys are both closed, power gets through, and you get a one. And in every other scenario, it blows that, and you get a NOR. Yeah, we don't even... I'm blowing past these. Is that okay? Is that giving anybody heartburn?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I really think we beat the heck out of this, you know what I mean, in the NOR gate part of the OR gate. We already went through it.
Yeah, sounds good to me.
All right. And the vocal minority gets to carry the day because if there are no other opposing voices, there you have it, you know. Okay. And then we're going to get to the scenario where they're both on and we know that's going to end badly. Badly. And we're going to get zero out the other side. Okay. This is just to show you again the other notation that you're going to see in some places, right? Which, again, I don't like. I still prefer the left one. But also for some of you that are like computer engineering, you know, types that have had some of this stuff or whatever, you may have seen notation like this. And it's also to kind of help you make the connection if this is what you've seen before. But I don't like this because I don't want to have to read. I can look at that and just intuitively know what that graphic does. I can know what this graphic does. In the same way that the little arrowhead just tells me intuitively graphically. But imagine there were no arrowheads, but there was just a word that was like out and the other word said in and there were no arrows. It's harder to make that connection in your head off of just words. Okay, ready for the next one? think you are. And if you're not, please scream inside your heart. Okay? Because the rest of us need to stay safe. AND gate. You know how the AND works? That this is the symbol for the AND gate. Like the OR gate, instead of going to a point, it goes more roundy. That's it. You know the truth table already, right? I got to have them both on for that guy to be on, right? I got to have them both on for that to be on. That's AND. If either one is off, it's off. Okay? Now, what about this guy? What's C? Spoiler alert again. What is C?
C's an OR.
No.
Or it's an OR.
Keep going.
Wait, it's a NAND.
That's it's a it. NAND. NAND. Not AND. Exactly. It's just the, it just generates the truth table for AND, but everything's backwards. So then you have to NOT it or invert it to get the AND. And once again, it's simpler to make the NAND gate than to make the NOR gate. Sorry. Yes. Sorry. Back up. It's simpler to make the NAND gate than to make an AND gate. Just like it was simpler to make a NOR gate than it was to make an OR gate.
Gotcha.
That seems hard to say for some reason. I think it's because an OR and a NOR are literally the same letters. And the only difference is where you put the space. And I think that's probably what's traumatizing me. Do it. NAND, baby. NAND right there. It's just the AND gate with the little dot. That's it. And you can immediately, again, this is not hard. You look at that, you're like, okay, the NAND gate goes whatever the opposite of the AND is. Oh, with a NAND gate, it's only off if they're both on over here. Otherwise, it's on. Boom. And there we have it again. There's my NAND gate inside. Now, interestingly, I'm going to pause for a second and just, let's do this a little bit manually. I don't have this one animated. Because this is actually a point when I'm doing this in classroom where we just like walk over to the screen, you know what I mean? Draw on the screen with a marker with a dry erase. Yeah, that guy is me that does that. No, actually I've never done that. But if you look at it, if you look at it for a second, notice the things that you're starting to look for. That guy over there on the right, boom, inverter. That's all that is, right? He's just a NOT gate. So that anything comes in low on C, goes out high on D. Comes in high on C, goes out low on D. Just flips it, whatever it is. Notice also that you got two P-type gates up here, and then two N-type gates in here. Again, burning down the house. We're trying not to burn down the house. So we just have to flip whatever. So when that guy's on, same input, right? A's going into both of these. When that guy's on, that guy's off. That guy's off, that guy's on. Whatever it is, I'm going to flip it. That keeps us from burning down the house. So that's all that stuff is down there. Now, this is the other interesting thing, which might be, I don't know. I hope this is interesting. Let's go back to, look at that NOR gate. Look at how the position is. Power comes, hits the A gate. If it survives, then it keeps going, and then it hits the B gate. Okay? And how many of this A and B does it take to blow the circuit on that guy? How many does it take to blow the circuit?
Blow as in keeping it off?
Blow as in, yeah, making so that the power can't get through.
Only one.
Only one. Right, because this thing is actually, it's serial, it's sequential, right? It's like, I got to hit A, and then I got to also hit B. Now that sounds like AND, but we're using that in the OR and the NOR. Like, what the crap? Well, if you think about it, what I'm basically saying is either one can blow it. Either one can say no. If either one of them, you know, is a one, I say no. And which is a NOR logic. It's exactly the opposite of an OR. Then as long as I flip it, I get the OR. Okay? In contrast, look at the AND gate. Notice anything there? It's a little hard because it's drawn, you know what I mean? It's kind of like wrapped around like modern art or something. But can you see something about the A and the B and the inputs, you know, these two gates? What about these guys? In contrast. What's that?
The power comes to them separately?
Yeah, they're parallel. So they're both separately powered. Now, by the way, see that little looks like your T-bone right here? You know, that's the power source, you know, coming from up there somewhere. Okay. And then going out with the arrow. But in this case, these guys are parallel. So they each have their own separate power. Now, how many of A and B does it take to blow this thing up and say no?
Both.
That's right. I got to have A and B have both got to be on for me to blow this circuit. If either one of them isn't cooperating, the answer is no. They have to both be on for this. Well, they have to both be off. I mean, that it takes cooperation from both of them, right, to do the thing. There you have it. So when they're both zeros, we get power goes through, and if either one of them is a zero, right? If either one of them is a zero, power gets through. But if they're both ones, then it blows up. And again, that's exactly the opposite of and, but literally the opposite. So if I just flip it, I get the truth table for and from NAND. Is that cool? But you can begin to see the little workings of the binary logic, right? And how Dr. even at
the... What are these kinds of diagrams called?
I would call them circuit diagrams.
Okay.
I don't know. That's
circuit diagrams, logic gates.
Yeah.
Transistors.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know.
Just wanted to double check on that.
Yeah, well, and it's also one of those things where it's like just never a space... I've never worked in a world designing at this level, right? So I don't know what they say when they walk in up and down the halls, because I've seen things that are called circuits, you know, or circuit schematics. This is sometimes called a schematic or a circuit diagram or, you know, I don't know.
I just have a feeling I'm going to need to take some extra time to research this on my own, and I was wondering what they were called, so I would know what to search for.
You bet. Okay. Now, so before we move on, we did not, we did nor, we did or, we did NAND, we did AND. That's it, right? Got any questions at all? And that was a good one. Any other questions? Anything nagging at you? Anybody else have Boingo in their head right now? Because that's not the worst case.
I don't know what that is.
That was the music I was playing when we started.
Oh, okay.
That was Oingo Boingo. An unsung heroic band from the 80s. Okay. Any last shot? Last shot at questions? Okay. Now it turns out, we're moving on. Turns out you can do, you know, we talked about how like, OR is a binary function, right? Because it has two inputs. I got a hot mic somewhere. I think literally a hot...
My bad.
I think I got a hot mic.
Hey.
Okay. Sorry for that. We talked about, you know, how AND and OR are binary functions because they take two operands, right? And how not is a unary operator because it takes one. That's still true-ish, but it turns out I can make larger gates with multiple inputs and frankly multiple outputs. Okay, which we'll talk about that. But what about this guy? What is this guy? Take a look at it. Well, I mean that ought to tell you right there that. That graphic shape right there, and then look at the truth table. What is this? What would you call it?
AND gate.
with three inputs. And what's the condition for that AND gate? What?
All three have to be.
Yeah. It's still just AND. All three have to be on. When they're all on, we say yeah. If they're not all on, we say no. Cool. Okay, now here's where we're going. Combinational logic circuits. Now this, I just want to say, that's a much scarier sounding slide. Combinational logic circuits. No. You know, it's like when you talk about multivariate analysis. What does that really mean? It means that more than, you know, one variable is changing while you figure out what's going on. You know, it's one of those just terminology things. Combinational logic circuits, it just means we're still doing logic, but we're going to put them together with a few other things and build some other stuff. That's all that means. All right. Now, it turns out, now, and this is the crazy, seriously, this kind of blows my mind, but this is the crazy part about all this circuit stuff. But what we've done with the transistors, P-type, N-type, the fundamental idea that power comes, you know, to the gate and that there's another source that turns that gate on or off, right? That closes or opens the gate. And that's the data line, and that the power gets through or not, and that's the output data line. That idea, and then really what we've built already with the AND, NAND, OR, NOR, and NOT, that's the building blocks. We take these same ideas and we build these other things, and pretty soon we've got memory, which is coming later. We got this decoders, multiplexers, full adders. It all is just a few more of those same ideas, which is just insane to me. One thing to just kind of keep in mind, there's no memory at this point, okay? There is power flowing. It's like you turn on the power, you turn on the water, turn the hose on, turn the hose off. It's whatever is going on right now, okay? So the power is like, you know, just the current configuration of power, that's what it is. In a second, that power might stop and it would be something different, okay? And we're going to talk about, so we call these decision elements because they're not about memory, they're not about hanging on to anything. They're just about, if this is what's flowing, what, you know, given this flowing in, what flows out. That's all that's saying right now. Okay, so it's nothing about holding on to that somewhere. That's memory, and we'll talk about it later. But it turns out we need decoders. We need these things to build memory, but we're going to build it. Crazy. And by the way, I will give you extra credit. I don't know how much. That's my way of hedging. But I will give you extra credit if you, like, build this crap in Minecraft. You can build, and without like stealing somebody else's Minecraft LC3, you know, please have integrity. But you can build these circuits out of, I mean, Minecraft.
Redstone.
What is it?
Redstone.
Redstone? What?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know what it is.
It's right. It's just like electrical wiring component kind of thing within Minecraft.
It's Redstone is the module or the package.
Redstone is just like
the material
wiring.
Oh, that's the material in Minecraft that you use.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Clearly not Minecraft literate. I've tried to do Minecraft. I swear to you, I've tried everything, and nothing has hooked me since Doom.
It's not for everyone.
Honestly, it just never has. Honestly, I've tried, like with my boys, you know, whatever doing. By my boys, I mean my sons. You know, I've tried it all, man. I don't know what happened. What's that?
Minecraft with the boys.
Let's get some brewskis and throw down some Minecraft. No, it never hooked me. I'm so sorry. And I am an ancient gamer. Just understand that. I played the original Pong. So shut, in the words of both of our presidential candidates, so shut up. I, you can now, yeah, nobody can criticize you now. You're being presidential when you say shut up.
I think the oldest game that I've played is Minesweeper.
Yeah, yeah.
That's probably the oldest, but that was like, that's probably past your era. Not
yeah,
man.
Yeah, that's right. I'm going back to Pong, going back to the early 70s. I'm going to Atari and television, you know.
You have ET, though, for the 2600.
Nice. I did.
Okay, I happen to have played, like, I think it's Zork.
Okay.
One of those original type text adventure games. So, that's an old one.
Yeah, yeah. And, of course, no one here is going to compete when it comes to, like, matching, you know, scar tissue from age. But I did play Adventure, the original Adventure, running on a single 5 1/4 inch floppy drive in my roommate's, it was an x86 machine that he had built himself, or was it 8088? It was 1984, and it was running, CPM was the operating system running on that thing. And it was the original Adventure. You are standing outside of a cave or whatever, the original, original, you know, I played the original Tetris. In 1989, literally the original, the binary that came from Russia from Alexei Pajitnov. And anyway, and then somewhere along the line, I blame the Nintendo paddles. I'm sorry. Stop it. Anyway, Minecraft to me, anyway, I don't know what happened to me. I got old and senile.
It's the most purchased game in the world.
Minecraft?
Minecraft. Last year, Minecraft bypassed Tetris for the most copies of any game sold in history.
Wow. In history? Wow. Yep. Not Angry Birds?
No.
Angry Birds was great, by the way, can I just say. Okay. I liked Angry Birds. And Zombies, Plants vs. Zombies. But... here's the thing. Minecraft. That's how we got onto this. You can build these things in Minecraft if you're a Minecraft person. There are other tools you can find where you can just start. Again, if your heart goes there, if you're not, you're like, seriously, Dr. K, shut up. If you don't care about all that crap, don't worry about it. But if you want to do something more, build a full adder in Minecraft or use some other, there are different things, right? Plugins. Maybe we can... Zach, you know some of these as well, I think, right? I mean, we can, like, just drop some of these into the comments. If somebody has, like, how do I get to that or whatever, you know, feel free to drop those in the comments for everybody in the chat on Discord. Okay, but let's talk about these. Are you ready? This is just, the biggest problem with where we're going right now is what we were just doing was, like, oh, ores, we know what that is. Ands, we know what it is, right? Even the nors and the nans, we're like, no, I got the idea. Nots, we understand it at a logical level, but like, what's a decoder at a logical level? What's a multiplexer at a logical level? You know what I mean? We don't have the intuition yet. So I'm going to try to give that to you. So here's the idea behind a decoder, okay? The decoder basically says... I got a bunch of lines going out. I've got a bunch of lines going out, and I've got some kind of like a selector line, okay? And it's gonna basically go, one of the patterns coming in is gonna turn on one of those lines going out. A different pattern will turn on a different line. Now, do you remember, were we talking? No, I was talking about it in 305G. About an early game that I did, that I played, which was this, it was a game you played on this calculator, and the calculator, if anybody wants to go looking for these, they were vacuum tubes where the filament had the shape of a number. So just picture, you can go look for them. Apparently there was, this showed up in some movie, Tomorrowland. It was in Tomorrowland, that movie, which was actually better than it got credit for. Just want to say. But so if you selected one of the patterns, it would turn on, you know, the one, the filament that looked like the number one. And another pattern of inputs would turn on the filament that looks like number two. This is my impersonation of the number two. Right? So that would be kind of a decoder where you're basically saying, when I send you, and there were 0 through 9, so it would have taken you 4 lines to do it, right? Because 3 only gets you 0 through 7. You don't have a way to get 8 and 9. So you'd have to have had 4 lines in. And when they were all off, then the 0 filament got lit up. And when there was, you know, just was just binary at that point. When it was, you know, what's your look? Yeah, that's what it looks like to you. 001, 0001. Then it would turn on the filament with the that looks like a 1, etc. Anybody find that? Somebody find vacuum tubes with numbers for the filaments. And it was in Tomorrowland, the movie. But it was also in my high school math room in the mid 70s. Anyway, but that's an example of the decoder, right? When it was a 1, it would turn on that filament. When it was a 2, it would turn on a different filament. 3, different filament. 4, different filament. Okay? Same kind of thing happens with LED readouts. Like you've got the classic, thank you. That's what I'm talking about.
That's it? Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Yep. That's it. Oh, that's a great close-up. Yeah, man, we had a calculator.
Oh, that's a way better than mine.
Yeah. Way to go, Mike. We had a calculator in my high school math class, and it had these were the outputs. That was the thing. I lived in Tomorrowland. That's not it, Jay. Sorry, man. But you're so close. Okay. But the same thing with LEDs, the classic LED, right? Where you have like, there's like line in the middle, line, right? And then you can make, you know, 5 goes like that and 8 is all of them and 0 is around. It's a similar idea. I've got, that's all done with circuitry where there's like a certain pattern coming in and that pattern is going to determine what goes, you know, what turns on going out. Okay? That's the idea. And we'll talk about decoders and multiplexers, and they're kind of similar, okay? They're kind of similar, and I don't care that you keep them separate in your head, as long as if you look at one, you would be able to tell what the function was. You know what I mean? You'd be able to look at it and go, oh, okay. All right, so that's what the decoder does. That's your intuition. The little LEDs are probably not a bad intuition on that. Okay, so, but the classic decoder has a bunch of lines. One of the, depending upon the pattern coming in, one of them is going to be on and the rest are going to be off. That's the classic. And so basically, if you got a line, so there's a line that has the value 1 that corresponds to a specific pattern that the decoder was designed to detect. That's the idea. So we'll see more later. But here we go. Okay. You got A and B coming in. I don't know if this is animated. Not animated. Okay, we got to do this the old-fashioned way. I got A and B coming in here. Now, you'll notice a couple things. Okay, these are AND gates, right? And then some of them have the little circles. We showed you a NAND gate, which had the AND, and then the little NOT gate was on the outs. Let's do it this way. Then the NOT gate was on the outs. My hand graphics are just suck. But there's like an AND, and the NOT was on the nose of it. And now I've got circles on the back side of it. On the input side. What is it? What's the explanation? What say you?
Just an inversion of whatever?
Yeah, they're just not gates, basically. Okay? But the reason that they're not on the other end of the AND gate, the reason they're not like like over here on that guy, is this allows me to take whatever's coming in on A, and
that's
I can,
what's inverted.
Exactly, right. So that does nothing unusual here on the top, because that just looks like a, that just operates exactly like a NAND gate, right? It does. They both get inverted, and then I AND them, as opposed to I AND them, and then I invert the answer. But down here, it's just a plain old, and that is literally just a plain old AND gate. If they're both on, it comes out one, right? Here, if they're both off, it comes out one. But what is going on in these middle two? That's where I'm going to invert one of them coming in, but not the other one. So there's a pattern here that you'll get. This will begin to be a little more second nature to you. But scout it. What's going on? Keep in mind that that's an AND gate. So they've got to both be on for us to get a one popping out the other side. But I'm sticking knots on the front of it. So little hints over here, right? The top guy, if A and B are both zero, you get a one, right? Because they both turn into ones. Yeah, I give you a zero and a zero. The knot goes, oh, you're now, I dub the one and one. One and one go into the AND gate. You see my, are you with my AND gate? I'm coming into you. One and one both come into the AND gate, and you get a one popping out. Golden. Down at the bottom, that's if I get a zero and a zero. Down at the bottom, if I get a one and a one, right? One and one, and you get a one out, right? But what happens when the one hits over here? If I go one and one over here on that first one,
it gets inverted into a zero.
Yeah, it blows up, right? You give me a single one coming into a NAND, coming into a NOT, and that turns it into a zero. And in an AND gate, when you're doing AND, a zero just blows it up. Zero just goes, no. They got to both be ones for me to say one. Okay? What about here? One and one. Nope. That knot blows it up, turns it into a zero. Well, how about down here? Nope, that knot turns the other guy into a zero, blows it up. The one and one only survives at the bottom. Now, what about zero and zero? Okay, up here, they both get flipped to ones. Boom, survives. What about down here? No, both zeros go into that AND gate. They both blow it up. Over here, I fix one of them, but I don't fix the other one. Right? Native zero coming in, boom, blows it up. How about here? Native zero, boom, blows it up. So when it's zero and zero, only this one allows that to survive on through. Okay? So what are these two in the middle doing then? What are they doing? I'm waiting for Bueller on this.
Only switching one of the inputs?
That's right. So if I come rolling in like this is like, this is for 0, 1. If I give it, so let's go all the way back. Let's go like 0, 1. 0, 1. Nope, right? The one gets inverted, blows it up. 0, 1 down here. No, 0 blows it up. Okay. 0, 1. Survival, right? The one gets, the zero gets flipped into a one, and the one's already a one. One and one, I get a one out. That same 0, 1 down here, zero blows it up, and the one turns into a zero, which also blows it up. So if I give you 0, 1 as A and B, only this second line is going to turn on. The others will be off. If you give me a one and a one, only that one at the bottom will turn on. You give me, right? So it allows me to make a decision. Like I'm going to give you a two-bit number that's going to be anywhere from 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1, 1. Going to be from 0 to 3. And based upon the number, literally based upon the number I give you, I'm going to turn on one line and leave the others off. That's cool, right? That's kind of cool. And we call that a decoder. And I don't like decoder. Nobody asked me back in the 50s or whenever they did this. And then we never really did 1, 0, but you just got the idea, right? One blows up. 1, 0. Well, the one blows up and blows up. The zero blows that up. But this one, the one, and then the zero turns into a one, survives. That guy goes on. Everybody else goes off if that's the inputs. Okay. What do you think? Anybody struggling with that? I know that you're like, yeah, I want to go on record as being the one of voices. That's why I'm struggling. If you are struggling with that, I would just assert the following. First of all, grab the TAs, you know, and walk through that if it's not making sense. The other thing is, if you understand what it's doing, the actual logic, not that hard, and there's some basic intuition, okay? The AND gate allows any zero to blow it up and forces it to be both ones to get through. The NOTs allow you in a pattern. Anybody recognize this pattern of NOT gates? What does that look like?
Looks like an NOR?
Ooh, more narrow, more narrow. I guess my question's more narrow. If I look at it as, do I have a knot or do I have a knot or don't I have a knot? It's like binary counting, right?
Like, that's what I'm thinking.
Right? Because if you looked at the knot gates and actually, if you just treated them as zeros, literally, if you treated them as the knot, the symbol of the NOT gate as a zero, you would read this from top to bottom, 00011011. It's basically binary counting, but it's basically saying every combination of two bits. It can only be one of four things. You give me two bits, I give you one of four possible answers. It could be zero, could be one, could be two, could be three. AKA could be 00, could be 01, could be 10, could be 11. And all I'm really doing is saying, when the number is zero, turn that guy on. When the number is one, that guy. Two, that guy. Three, that guy. That's all I'm doing. Crazy. Crazy. How we doing on time? We're doing great. We're killing it. Okay. That's a decoder. That shows up big, big when it's time to make memory. When it's time for us to make some memories, you will see how important this is. And making memories is very important, it turns out. Okay, that's decoder. We're jumping to multiplexer, which is a really similar idea, okay? We do sometimes refer to the multiplexer as a MUX. That's just the term. We'll sometimes call it a MUX. Okay. So what we're doing with a multiplexer is it goes kind of like this. A bunch of lines are coming in, and we're going to decide who gets through, okay? So imagine, you've seen, like, if you're on the freeway at rush hour, I'm going to draw you a picture, but when you're on the freeway at rush hour, there are these, like, we're going this way. So this is the freeway on-ramp. Anybody recognize that pattern? Right? That's kind of the on-ramp. And then this is the lineup of cars. And I don't have any cars there, but I'll give you some cars right now. And then okay, so the cars stack up, okay? Whatever, BYU fans and Utah fans, whatever. And by the way, this one there, that's a tribute to a thing that has occurred in the last 5 to 10 years that I do not, for the life of me, understand. But why do people come up to a car at a stoplight and stop like literally 20 feet behind that car? Can anybody? You're young. This is your generation. It's not an age thing either. It's not just like old people like me. It's like everybody, and young people like you. I have a theory, but it doesn't even fully explain it.
I have no idea.
But have you observed it? You know what I'm talking about?
I've observed it like once.
I have an idea.
Say it quick. Okay, I want to hear it.
So my idea is fuel consumption.
Well, I've observed really far behind.
Wait, hang on. Oh, yeah. Fuel consumption is one theory. I reject your theory.
Fuel consumption and the fact that you can actually increase your speed when you're behind someone that much, because you keep the car going at a consistent rate until the light turns green, and then you go as soon as that person goes.
Okay.
It's just a thought. It's a thought.
No, it's a good thought. It's a good thought. Yeah. I retract my rejection.
I don't know if I'm right or wrong, but it's just a thought. It's maybe spark some thought there.
My theory is that if you take the time to cozy up, you lose texting time. And that if you stop back here, you stop faster. So I start texting while I've got a window. But if I burn an extra couple seconds, right? I don't even know, right? I don't know. I just know it makes me crazy.
Is that the same reason why people stay behind semi-trucks and go slow so they can text for a long time?
No, I think that's different. That's possible, but I think it's different. Your mom, David's mom, doesn't, and she doesn't text. Blows that theory. I reject my own idea, right? I mean, I don't know. You know what I mean? Okay, but here's the deal. There's a stoplight up here, right? And the stoplight, depending upon how it's set up, let's just say that there's like a hanging thing of lights. And I'm going to do green lights at the bottom, right? And red lights are at the top. Yes. Is that true? People who have red-green color blindness actually have to, like,
know which one's on
know which one's bottom. Positionally, right, yeah.
Yeah, and then yellow in the middle. Yeah, you got it.
Yeah, yeah. And by the way, what I really love about the UK is their lights, when you're red, it goes yellow, then green to give you a wake-up that it's coming.
Yeah, so they do that in Germany, too.
Really? I love that. Love it. To me, it's like, I'm waiting. And in Utah, for whatever reason, after about 10 seconds of waiting, about 10% of all Utah drivers will fall just asleep, sound sleep.
People honk at them.
And then I got to be the one, you know.
So they reverse it in Germany and other places. They go red, green,
yellow, green. Because the yellow kind of alerts you. And yeah, I like it a lot. I think it lacks trust to not give us that.
It goes green, yellow, red, yellow, green. Goes like yellow is like the transition between both green and red, as it should be.
That's right. Okay, so what you notice here, if you can see my art, there's like three lights. They're hanging on this. This is a cable, okay? And there's three lights, and it's like that guy's off, and that guy's on. There's a lot of cars that are coming in to this three lines, right? But that light switch goes, okay, you go. So it's like a lot of options coming in, but I'm going to tell you what's going out the other side. I'm going to tell you, and this is the difference between a decoder, okay, and a multiplexer. The multiplexer has stuff coming in, and it decides who gets to go.
So that's, like JJ's learner said, that's the traffic control light for rush hour. So when there's a high amount of volume of people, one person can go, other person stop. Okay.
Exactly. That kicks in at rush hour. That's right. Exactly. And some of them have like two. The biggest one I've ever seen, I think, on I-15 is like three. And sometimes they'll even have one, but they'll just one because it's like spacing it just so you don't have everybody jammed in and jamming up there. It'll create a little go time.
Just a little tip. Get behind a semi when you're in those lanes because they're like two cars. So if
that's
you're behind
true.
One.
That's well. True.
Anyway, side note.
Yeah. All right. But so what that light is doing, so this is the critical difference. A multiplexer, there are options coming in. There's data coming in. Okay, now here's an example, and I should have done this differently, but imagine that I just crossed out that car right there, okay? No, it's not, you know, it's not her turn yet because we're still, you know, it's still red. But over here, I mean, you've seen that too, where like one lane stacked up and there's no one in the other one or whatever. It's still going to go, okay, you go, and then the red car will. Sorry, I cannot do this thing backwards. It's going to go, you go, and red car fills. And it's going to go, you go, and then ideally this one's smart enough to go all the way up. And then it's going to go, okay, you go, but there's nobody there. Okay?
So it's empty?
1, 1, 0. In other words, the multiplexer just gives your line a slot, a time, and says, okay, I'm going to have you be the one that goes. But you're like, yeah, but I'm 0. Still your time slot. Okay, nothing happened. 0 was in and 0 went out. See what I mean? So the multiplexer doesn't care necessarily like what your data was, whether you were a 0 or a 1. It just said, you go, now you go, now you go, now you go. And your 0 got through, your 1 got through, that guy's 1 got through. You know, her 0 went through. See what I mean? It's like kind of like a traffic cop, but the multiplexer has to have data coming in. The decoder didn't really have data coming in. You know what I mean? It's like the number 0 came in and it went, I'm going to create a signal for you with a 1 on that line. Right? And then when I got 3, which was 1, 1, it was like, I'm going to create a signal for you with a 1 on that line and the others are going to be zeros. See, the decoder's like, I'm going to give you a symbol, a pattern, and you're just going to like produce a 1. See the difference? The multiplexer says, I'm going to use a pattern. You're going to give me a pattern, but the pattern's going to tell me who gets to go, and whatever they are is what goes. If they were a 0, then the 0 gets on through. Okay? With you, Morgan, man. With you on that one. Does the multiplexer give a 0 to the other ones that don't go? No, they just don't go. Well, yes, sorry. I understand what you're saying now, David. Yeah, the lines on those are, I think they're just going to default to 0. They're not going to be anything. And we'll break it down as well. So on the multiplexer, you've got a certain number of inputs, right? In the case, in this one here, we had 3 inputs, right? 3 input lines. Now, to do 3 input lines, I have to have select lines, which tell me, imagine it was just 4. Imagine it was 4, which makes it a nice, you know, power of 2, right? If I had 4 lanes, I would have 4 inputs, 2 to the second. And I would have to have selector lines that would basically say, you go, now you go, now you go, now you go. Or maybe there's some other recipe, right? Maybe it bases it on something else. It wouldn't have to be strictly rotating. I just put the emphasis in rotating awkwardly, as if I suddenly were Christopher Walken. But what you're going to have here, if you look at it this way, is imagine that this guy is 0, 0, 0, 1, and 1, 0, and there's no 1, 1, okay? These are the selector lines, and literally, there is a multiplexer in that control for that traffic switch, for that traffic light. And it goes zeros, you know, it kind of, there's some little control that goes, I'm just going to count loop or whatever it does it. It goes 0, 0, and it just triggers the selector lines with 0, 0. And that causes this traffic lane to go green it goes green. Everybody's red by default. Causes that one to change to green for some period of time. Okay. Isn't that kind of cool? And then when it's time, it could just do like the next selector lines would be like 1, 0, and then that guy would go. And then 0, 0, and then that guy. Well, you know what it reminds me of? Somebody looked this up. It was a Key and Peele, who are freaking hilarious. But Keegan is trying to get on an airplane and they just keep selecting for everybody else. They're like, military, you know, first class, diamond upgrade,
military babies,
religious people with military babies, and they just keep like going, and then this guy is just like trying to get on the freaking plane, and he of course is losing his gourd. Anyway, it's check it out. There we go. Thank you. It's horrible. If you've done a lot of travel, this is horrible. Okay. So do you have the idea that there's got to be a certain number of selectors, and there's a relationship between the number of selecting lines I need to the number of input lines I need. If I've got four lines coming in, I need two selector lines to turn on all combinations. Right? And if I have eight lanes, I need three connector lines. All right? Here we go. By the way, I'm going to do, yeah, we're going to touch this. We're going to kind of wrap up here on multiplexers, and then we'll hit it Tuesday. We're going to come back to multiplexers and kind of like wrap up a little bit. But here's the idea, okay? Once again, you're going to see notation, and the notation is going to just start by like, you know, you're going to fuzz your eyes and you're going to be feeling a little funny. You're going to feel disoriented at first. And so then you just like, okay, just take a deep breath, do your breathing exercises, and go, okay, well, look, what's going on? What do the symbols mean? You know what that is. That's an OR. You know what these wires are. That's just wire. You know that's an AND gate. You know that's an AND gate. You know that's a NOT right there. A and B are the traffic lanes, okay? They're the data lines coming in. You don't know what they are. Here's the cool thing. Then S is the selector line, okay? Now, this is the critical thing. In this multiplexer, there are only two lanes, right? Or in other words, two data lines. Two lines, sorry, that was British. Apologize to all citizens of the UK that may have been offended by what I just did. You've got two lines coming in. It's just an awkward angle because of where my hand is. I'm not trying to be profane. How many selector lines do I need? I have two data lines. How many selector lines do I need?
One, because it's two to the first.
That's it. And when it's zero, I'm going to select one of them and turn the other one off. And when it's one, I'm going to select the other one, turn the other one off, right? So here it goes right there. This is it on the left. That's the whole thing. If the selector line is zero, then I permit A and I blow up B. See? I permit A with a zero and I blow B up. Because you drop a zero into an AND gate. And if I have a one, then I'm going to blow up A, but allow B. Okay? Is that making sense? And then here's the other cool thing. Here come A and B. Well, I don't know what A and B are. Doesn't matter. Let's just take, for example, S is 0, which is over here. Okay? I do S is 0. Well, 0 comes here to B. It blows it up, so it's a 0 no matter what B was. Okay? You with me here? It's a 0 no matter what B was. If B was a 0, still a 0. If B was a 1, still a 0. Cool? S equals 0 hits this NOT gate, and it turns this AND gate on, basically. It says whatever A was gets on through. So A survives. What if A was a 0? 0. What if A was a 1? 1. See? The selector is basically turning on that AND gate, okay? So that's why, even though I'm saying S is 0, A just survives. It gets to be A. Now, this is the other tricky part about the multiplexer that makes the whole thing work. I take all of the outputs coming out of those AND gates, and I just OR them together. Now, why in the crap am I going to do that? You have any guesses? Even if you don't know, take a stab. I'll mock you just a very short amount of time. I won't even mock you, really. Why are we throwing all those OR gates at the end? What say you? Come on, Bueller, I know you can do this. And by the way, is anybody talking and I'm not hearing you?
No, we're all intimidated.
Discord does that to me sometimes, right? So I just wanted to make sure I hadn't lost the audio coming back from you guys.
Sure.
Okay. I'll take the silence as a kind of like a Dr. K, please help us. Okay, here's the idea. That guy there, what does a zero do coming into an OR gate?
Nothing.
Now imagine that this was two selector lines and four data lines, right? One of those is going to be allowing the number to get through, and all the others are turning into zeros. It basically says, I'm going to have a way to allow all those zeros, whatever they are, to just drop into an OR gate, and whichever line I turned on, and whatever that data value is going to pop out and going to pass through and be out the other side. Hence, notice I got an A here and an A out there. If A had been 0, this would be 0. If A had been 1, that would be 1. A just survives. I'm just saying who survives. And then this is the one, we'll come back to this because we're like right at time, like 2 minutes over. If you want to get a jump on it, take a look at this one. 4 data lines, 2 selectors. But the concept is exactly the same. Notice the binary counting. 00, 01, 10, 11. The selecting line is going to turn one of those on and all the others off. Everybody is going to aggregate at that OR gate. And all the zeros are going to do nothing. And the one that we left on, whatever's going to survive is whatever the data line said. If it had been a 0, it would still be a 0. If it had been a 1, the 1's going to get pop out the other side. Boom, pen drop. And we're going to come back. We'll start right here. We'll double back on this one and just do a quick review before we jet, you know, keep moving forward, okay? And coming up, we've got just a little bit of a little trailer. We have an adder coming up. We're going to build an addition machine. We're going to add numbers. Amazing. And then we're going to talk about memory and storage. And the rest of this thing is going to basically be memory and storage. That's the bulk of it. We'll end with some state machine stuff. But in terms of like this lecture, this module. Okay. That's it. That's what I got. And I probably need some Boingo on the way out, right?
Dr. K, can I get some help on something?
Yeah, let's jump on. Let me see. Is this like generic that others might be interested in? Or is this more like, yeah, you know, I want to talk about my exam?
Module 3.
Okay. Yeah. So let me just, I'll leave it running just so we've got that for anybody else looking on YouTube later if they're interested. Okay. But in terms of like core lecture, we're done. So if anybody, you know, doesn't want to stick around and hear the question, or you're on YouTube or whatever, we're good, we're done. Okay. Yeah, so I'll hold off on my outro theme music for now. Okay, what do you got?
Okay, so I'm really kind of confused on 14, 20, and 21 for Module 3 homework.
So this is... 14. Wait, hang on. So this is homework 3... Module 3, and then which numbers again?
14.
Okay.
20 and 21.
All right, let me pull that up real quick.
Yeah, you're good.
Modules. Module 3. And we got homework. All right, this is the homework.
Mm-hmm.
Right there, just kind of for reference for everybody. And then we go, we're talking 14 right there.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Convert the following, so these are decimal numbers.
Yeah, so I was kind of confused. Convert the following decimal numbers to hex and then representations of 2's complement numbers. So converting 256 to hex in 2's complement, I'm not sure how to go about
when
can you help me out there?
Yeah, absolutely. When you just read that, you actually read it and you added a verb in between hexadecimal and representations.
I did. What was that?
That was a mistake. That was a misinterpretation of what this thing is about.
Well, then I'm glad I asked you for help because that's
exactly.
That up
to yeah, right on, right on.
I would have got that totally wrong.
Yeah. So here, I'll try to piece it apart. So there are two's complement numbers, right? There are binary numbers. Numbers are numbers, but
right.
But a number complement can be a two's
signs, though, right?
That's yeah. Right. Two's complement okay. Being a way of encoding signs,
right?
And I can take any binary number and represent it as hex.
Right.
Right? So yep. What this is saying, so this is converting these decimal numbers, you know, and I'm just telling you these are decimals, even though you wouldn't know it by looking at it whether B was binary or, you know what I mean? So I'm telling you that they're decimal. Yep. And then I'm saying, I want you to convert these numbers into hexadecimal representations of two's complement numbers. So in other words, what that means is I need you to take these decimal numbers, convert them into binary.
And then convert them into two's complement and then convert them into hexadecimal.
No. You convert them into binary.
Okay.
Close, but you added a step that it doesn't exist. You don't convert it to binary and then convert it into two's complement.
Okay, gotcha.
Two's complement is a form of representation for binary numbers.
Okay, yeah.
So you convert it into binary numbers using two's complement notation as the social contract.
Okay.
For how we encode
this. Is zero or a one, either positive or negative at the front being a sign notation, right? Because two's complement is signed, isn't
it? Oh, yeah, no, absolutely.
Okay.
But what it means, for example, is like 256, you know, that's actually fairly easy, right? I mean, it's a nice power of two, but you start by just converting that and it's a positive number, right?
Right.
So, and you know what I realized, what I just realized?
What?
Hang on a second. Well, okay, what I didn't say in this thing is that because we're going to convert it to hex, you have to pad to the nearest 4 bits to make it hex digits. See what I mean? If I do a thing where I go...
like pad meaning like put zeros?
Yeah, leading zeros or leading ones, right? So if I have a number and that number is like... what's an example?
That's what the last question actually is. Convert falling two's complement binary to 8-bit, which would pad something on the beginning, but we'll get to that.
Yeah. Well, so imagine I had this as my number, right?
Okay. That would be a negative two's complement.
Exactly. But I didn't specify how many bits it is. So gotcha. All I need to know is that the leftmost is what I care about. But if I'm going to represent that as a hex number and it's two's complement, then I have to pad to get 4 and then 4.
Oh.
It would not be cool to go, oh, my number is 7, you know, 7-6. My number is 7-6 hex.
Right.
No, because then when I converted it, I'd get that, and that is not a negative number. That, right?
Right.
That's a positive number. So that's that. If you know what you're doing, that should also be, I shouldn't have to say it, but let me say it. Now, does that kind of fix what you need to know for 14?
So I would just convert it to binary, and then from there I would pad it, and then I would get the hexadecimal notation from that, correct?
Yeah, you'd pad it to the nearest 4 bits. Because every hex digit is 4 bits.
256 in hex digit notation is 0100, correct?
Yes.
So would I pad 4 zeros at the beginning of that?
No, you don't need that. It could just be hex 100.
So spell O-Hex-100?
Yeah, that works. Or 0100 also works.
Okay. So I'm just basically converting these numbers into hex representation.
That's right. But keeping in mind that if you have a negative number, that binary representation that you roll into hex has to be 2's complement notation.
Right.
So it has to follow the social, has to follow the social contract, which, you know, to summarize super quickly, is I would take 44, find what the decimal representation was, right? Then I would have to convert that into a negative number,
which would switch all digits,
flip all the bits, and then add one. Yeah. Right. That's how I would convert positive 44 to negative 44 in 2's complement. Then that number having been switched, I'd go, okay, 4 digits. That's one hex, next 4 digits, another hex.
Right.
And if there was a padding, I would have to pad with ones, because otherwise I'm going to screw it up when you go the other way.
Okay, great. Awesome. I think I'll be able to do that one then.
Okay.
Pretty well. Number 20, I don't know how to do that one.
Okay, I'm going to give you...
Start phrase.
ASCII?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, let me do this. Really, really quick.
So I know the number representation 4-3 in can be used to convert the binary representation to number 3.
Okay, this is the most butt ugly ASCII code table I could find, which happens to be a scan out of the book. Okay, but this is the one in the book. There are more elegant looking ones. Like the ones we use on the exam are better looking than this. Yeah. Okay, so the question
is... I have that in the book too, so...
Okay, yeah. So, what arithmetic operation, what math operation can you use to convert...
So that would be plus, minus, times, divide?
Yeah.
Is that arithmetic? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And what could I do? So, and I'm kind of giving you a little bit of a hint here, but the ASCII, everything you need to know to answer that question is staring at you right here. Okay?
Okay.
In the ASCII table. That's the other hint. But let's just take a look. So there's the binary number 3, right?
Yeah. In decimal form, the hex decimal is 03.
That's right. It would be hex 03, decimal 3, binary, right. Binary 00000011, right? So that's just the number 3, the value 3.
Right. Yep.
Now, I want to convert that into the ASCII representation for the character 3. See, if I send 3 out to the printer or out to the screen, I'm going to get, I don't even know what that is. I'm going to get that guy. You know what I mean? That's what 3 is. No good.
ETX, yeah.
ETX. I don't even know what it is. I've probably known once in my life for like 4 seconds. Okay? But that's not what I want. I need, where is it? I'm looking at my big screen here. Yeah, I'm right there. That's the character 3. And that decimal is 51. Hex is 33, or 33 hex, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what do I have to do?
So go to the character 3 and invert it to decimal form 51?
Well, there's no inversion there. You're not inverting anything. But convert, I mean...
Would you convert 51 into binary then?
No. No, you're not... No, no that's okay. All like losing the forest for the trees.
Okay.
Keep in mind, what this is trying to get you to think about is the fact that there's a number called 3. And there's also a character called 3.
Mm-hmm.
They're not the same thing, right?
Right.
The character called 3 has a value, a number value, which is decimal 51 or hex 33, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if I just told you, hey, here, man, here's the number 3. I want you to print the character 3. And I didn't. And you learned this trick, and then I took the ASCII table away from you. What would you do to if I gave you the number 3 and said I want you to print the character 3? What number would you give to the printer?
I'm not sure.
Well, if I said print the number 3, what number would you give to the printer? Ignoring the rest of the question. Let me put it this way. If I gave you the letter capital K and said print a capital K to the printer, what number would you give to the printer and say, print this character, and you gave it a number? What number would you give it?
75?
Decimal, yep. Yep, yep, yep. Or 4B hex. Same number, right?
Yeah.
Okay?
Yep.
So if I said, tell the printer to print the character 3, what number would you give the printer?
51.
51. So if I told you 3, I said, here's the number 3, print its character equivalent, what would you have to do to the numerical value 3? I'm going to make this like really broken down. What would you have to do to the numeric value 3 to cause it to become the numeric value 48? Sorry, 51. I gave it away. Right? What would you have to do to the numeric value 3 to turn it into the numeric value 51?
You would... I'm still...
Let's make it simple. If I said 5, I gave you the number 5, and I said, do something to this number such that it becomes 6, what would you do to it?
You would add 1.
Right. Now, if I gave you the number 3 and said, do something to this so that it becomes the number 51, what would you do to it?
Oh. You would add the difference between 51 and 3.
That's it. And the observation, which is 48 in decimal, the observation is that these just the numbers 0 through 9, the characters 0 through 9 are, in fact, notice that the character 0 is 48. So if I gave you a number and you knew it was a single-digit number, and I added 48 to it, it would turn it into the value of the character for that number. I give you a 0, you get 48. 48 is the character for 0. I give you the number 1, you add 48. Now you've got the character for 1. And it's true of all the numbers.
Interesting.
Does that make sense?
Okay.
Is that light coming on or is it still struggling?
No, it makes sense.
And here's where it's going to be huge. Upper to lower, lower to upper. If I say, here's a number and it's an uppercase value, it's a letter, and it's uppercase, make it lowercase without consulting the ASCII table. There's a relationship between the values of the uppercase characters and the lowercase characters.
Mm-hmm.
See what I mean? The difference is hex 20. So I can convert any letter from A to Z into the uppercase version, you know, going that way, or the lowercase version, by either adding or subtracting hex 20.
Right.
Boom. Convert. So it's a lot, it's trying to get you to separate the idea that there are numbers that have their own value, and there are characters, which are a different thing. The character is that 8-bit, in this case, 8-bit number that we hang on to know how to print something or input it from the keyboard or make it go on the monitor or whatever.
So in that example, you would take, where's the character 33 again? So you would, in order to get from hex decimal 3 to the character 3, you would just add 30 to the hex?
30, that's right. 30 hex. You would add to that value.
Okay.
And that would give you the ASCII value for the character.
Right. Okay, great. Yep.
Does that help? And then I think 21, having talked about 14, probably now makes more sense.
The padding thing?
No. 21, well, 21 says convert it into 8-bit 2's complement. Oh, without changing the values. That is kind of... Yeah, that's right. That is about padding.
Okay, so you just add a, let's see, that's a negative number. So you would add 1's to the beginning.
Yep.
Okay, and then that would make it an 8-bit 2's.
That's right, you'd have to add 4 1's to that guy.
Okay.
And the second guy, let's just kind of do them real quick.
Two zeros at the end?
Let's call it the begin, I don't know, on the left. I would pat it with two zeros to the left. Yep. Let's go to D because it's a little more straightforward. What do you do to that guy?
Could you not do it to the right as well?
No, because that's every. You have a zero to the right.
Oh, no,
you
just, no. If you have right? a zero to the right, the digits go up.
You okay, just yeah. multiplied it by two.
A ton, yeah.
Yeah, uh-huh. Hence, you know, without changing the values. 0, 1, what do you got to do to make that one into an 8-bit number?
I'm looking at C too.
Yeah, hold off on C.
Oh, hold off on C. Okay. In order to make that an 8-bit number, you would add 6 zeros to the very beginning, to the left of
yep.
the zero.
Okay, now what about C? C is a little more tricky.
Okay, yeah, so it is a little tricky. Let's see, 4, 8, 9, 10.
It's 10 bits.
Right, so would you take two ones off the left?
Mm-hmm. Got right? It. No blood, no foul, right? If that was a positive number and there were a bunch of, you know, and it was 12 zeros and then a bunch of stuff, and I said make that guy an 8-bit number, you just truncate the zeros. You don't care, right?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
Awesome. Well, thank you for your help.
Yeah, man, you bet. You bet. Okay, good luck. I don't know who else is on.
Hey, Dr. K, I have a quick question about Module 4.
Yeah.
On the homework, I just want to make sure my logic through this is right.
Okay.
I'm trying to pull up the homework.
Yeah, let me pull it up as well.
Okay, so the first question, these are going to be really quick, but number two, if you have it pulled up, sorry, I don't see it.
I'm pulling it up right now. You said module 4, right?
Yeah, module 4. Right. Homework 4.
Yeah, way to be cranking on the one we're actually talking about in class. No time like, you know, no time like the present, right? Like yeah. Hit it while it's fresh. Hit it while it's fresh. Okay.
No, that's true. So on number two, when I look at it, I'm kind of realizing that everything is dependent on C for the most part. So like if C is not zero, then the out is going to be zero, right? Does that make sense? And then I need an A or a B to be a zero also. It doesn't matter. But like if C is not zero, then the out has to be zero.
Let me see. Let's since there's only two options, instead of talking about it not being zero, let's talk about what it must be, okay? So yeah. here we go. If C is one, then that guy's shut off. That's right. So you know that whenever C is one, it's got to be a zero on the out. So you could literally just go, okay, zero, 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 right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah? Now the question is, I mean, and you do know that.
And okay, I'm just making sure I wasn't like mess. Yeah, okay. Yeah, no, so even if you say that a lot, it makes more sense to me. So yeah. I think I'm good on that one.
And then similarly, right? And then it's just kind of getting you to go, okay. Then okay, when A and B, the other way you can do this thing is just go, look, A, put a zero. Imagine zero here. Power comes. A goes in, the zero says, yeah, turn it on, you know? Mm-hmm. And in fact, you only need to do the ones where the C is zero. Because you already determined that when C is one, you're dead anyway. So ignore those. You know, they're already zero. You already know.
Then it's just an either or, like if A is zero or B, like, yeah, if those, okay, that
exactly.
makes sense.
That's exactly right. Yeah, you got it. So you got it.
The last one is for number four. I'm assuming not A is just A. Is that right?
No, so here's the deal. There's precedence. So you have to look at the fact that I got to do not B and I got to do not A and I got to OR those together and then not that because, and I don't know if that's like typographically unclear.
No, it's fine.
You know what I mean? It's not the quantity, you not the mm-hmm. whole quantity because the parens are out there.
Okay. Yeah. So I did it wrong then. And then that second part of that question will make sense, I'm sure, when I figure that out.
Okay. Yeah, that's right. At that point, you got to noodle it. Once you look at the truth table, you're like, well, that just acts like whatever. Yeah, that's all that is.
Yeah.
Yeah. You just noodle that and puzzle it out.
Okay. Well, that's all I needed.
Okay.
Thank you.
Awesome. Okay, I'm going to shut down my YouTube factor. Hopefully that's helpful for some, you know, watching on YouTube.